Hello, my name is Frank Mealy. I am the president and founder of Pegasus Lectures. We will now cover the fifth in a series of modules entitled Statistics Made Easy. In this fifth module, we'll be discussing the t-test. In general, the t-test is a standardized method for determining if two distributions have the same mean. What do we mean by two different distributions? Well, we could be measuring data from, let's say, two different groups of students who went to attend a different school, see if they have the same IQ. See if the school has an effect on IQ. Or perhaps we could be comparing two different drugs and comparing the efficacy of those drugs as a specific treatment for a disease. Or perhaps we could be looking at, say, fertilizing versus not fertilizing in plant heights, or maybe even different amounts of fertilizer in plant heights and plant growth. Okay? In any case, what we're talking about is two different distributions, two different measurements, either before and after treatment, or two different types of treatments. Well, you might ask yourself, well, why not just calculate the means of the two data sets and see if they are close enough? If we're really trying to do is say if they have the same mean. Well, the answer to that question is quite simple. How do you know when close is close enough? And another problem, what if you have a limited number of samples to compare? So let's say you only have a few data points, or not that many data points. Now what could happen is you could end up believing that the two distributions are the same when they're really not. They're actually from different distributions. Different distributions, but they appear to be as if they're from the same distribution because you have limited data. Howard, I'm going to repeat from right here. The answer to that is, how do you know when close is close enough? And the other problem is, what if you have a limited number of samples to compare? This could make you believe that the samples from these two different distributions are really from the same distribution when in fact they're not. Or that from different distributions when they're from the same distribution. So either way, you can be confused into believing that they really are the same or they're really not. And it's not because the data really proves that, but rather because you have undersampled your space. So we need a formalized method of determining whether or not data is from the same mean or not, same distribution or not. I want to repeat that one more time from here. Well, the answer is, how do you know when close is close enough? And the other problem, what if you have a limited number of samples to compare? This could make you believe that the samples are from the same distribution when they are not, or from different distributions when they really are from the same distribution. In those cases, you've convinced yourself of something that's not really true, not because the data really says it, but because you have an undersampling of data. Okay, so we need a formalized method of determining whether or not we have the same mean, whether or not two distributions really are the same. Well, a specific t-test called the paired t-test. As the name suggests, paired implies the data points are paired, they're coupled. So you use this when you have a before and after measurement, or when measurements are linked together, i.e. paired. So for example, we could be comparing left versus right patient by patient. So in other words, on patient A, we compare left versus right, then patient B, left versus right. Okay? So really checking, we have a measurement on the same patient before and after, or left and right. Two different angles for measuring, again, patient by patient. Okay? Or perhaps we're looking at a drug and the effects, we measure the patient before the drug and then after the drug. Again, these measurements are paired. Same patient, a sample before and afterwards. Or we could be looking at, say, test scores measured before and then after a specific training course. Now, we're going to go back and use that null hypothesis that we talked about earlier to be able to determine whether or not the distributions or the means are the same. And remember, the null hypothesis says that there was really no effect. So the null hypothesis for a t-test means that the mean difference between the paired observations is zero. There's no difference. So in terms of the examples we've given, when we said left versus right, patient by patient, the null hypothesis would mean that the left and the right give the same results. Left is the same as the right. Or, in this case, that the angles didn't matter. They make a difference in the measurement. Or in this case, the patient was the same before and afterwards. Or in other words, the drug had no effect. And finally, in this example here, that the training had no effect on the test scores. So when we test the patient, the students before and then after the training course, they really had the same results, the same distribution. Well, as the name suggests, an unpaired t-test means that we don't have this coupling or pairing of the data. So you use this when you have a before and after measurement within two different groups, these groups that are not paired. For example, let's now say that we have group one, in which we measure left, versus group two, in which you measure right. So notice this is not left and right in the same patients. It's left on the one group and right on a different group. Or we measure two different angles, group one versus group two. So all the angles for group one are the same, and then all the angles for group two are the same. Or patients measured without a drug in group one, and then with a drug, group two. Or our fourth analogy was, let's say test scores measured without the training course, all in group one, and then with the training course in group two. Okay. Perhaps we'll drive home this point is, let's consider a drug for Parkinson's disease and the use of a paired t-test. So imagine that this drug company produced a drug that claims to control the tremors associated with Parkinson's disease. Further, let's imagine that there's a computer-based test which tests the ability of a person to stay manually on a target, with scores ranging from, say, 0 to 100. Now, of course, people have different capabilities before taking a drug, and these capabilities will probably vary from day to day. So if you measure them today and then tomorrow, the same patient may have a different score, just because of their ability on that given day. So you do a before and after drug administration test on 22 patients and get the following results. What you see in this table is, we see in some cases, the before and after went up, sometimes it went down, okay, up again, up a little bit, down. So it seems to be going in all different directions. So did the drug have an effect or not? Well, we could look at the means, and the mean before was 34.8, the mean afterwards was 37.2. How significant is that? Well, we don't really have a great sense. I mean, maybe the difference of 3 points is huge, or maybe it really effectively means very little. If we look at the variance, what we see is a larger variance on the after as before, which may further indicate that maybe it's just the normal spread of the day and it's not really the effect of the drug. So even though the mean is higher, it may just be the normal variance within the normal spread that you expect, just being the fact that there's error in your measurements from day to day. Well, let's look at the results of the t-test, the paired t-test. Now in the paired t-test, when you run the calculation, you end up with a t-stat of 2.51. And the t-critical is 2.08. So what we see is that t-stat is greater than t-critical, and we end up with a low p-value, below 0.05, which means we end up with a low p-value. Remember, we reject the null hypothesis, and the null hypothesis was the drug had no effect. So since we reject that null hypothesis, we want to say that we believe that the drug possibly had some positive effect on controlling tremors. Okay. Now, let's say instead of running the paired t-test, we ran the normal t-test, okay, the unpaired t-test. Now what would happen? Well, realize that when we ran the paired t-test, we had the test on the same patient before and after the drug, whereas when it's unpaired, all we're looking at is two big clumps or distributions in which we not really look at the patient before and afterwards. So we're actually losing some information. So in this case, even the t-stat ends up being 0.32, and t-critical is 2.018, so that we have a higher p-value, much greater than the 0.05, which means we fail to reject the null hypothesis, and we can't say that the drug actually had an effect. It's quite conceivable, at least from these results, we believe that the drug had no effect. In essence, we ran the wrong test because the results really were paired, and we didn't use a paired t-test. Well, let's go further with this idea and say that someone argues that the results of the last test was a placebo effect. So in that first case where it said, when we used the correct test, the paired t-test, and it said there seemed to be an effect, let's say someone says, you know what, that's really just a placebo effect. So in order to disprove this theory, another test is run. So in this case, we use a computer-based test to pre-scan patients and select only patients that fall into a certain range, let's say between 20 and 25. Then the patients that meet this criteria are then randomly assigned to group A, the placebo group, and group B, the drug group. So we find patients in the range of 20-25, and then we randomly distribute them to group A and group B. A we're going to give the placebo to, and B we're going to give the drug to. and then we're going to test each group. Since there is no before and after, again, we're not taking the same patient and testing them before a drug and after. Now we have two distinct groups, okay? We cannot do a paired t-test. Instead, we do a t-test with the null hypothesis that the means of the two groups are equal, implying that the placebo would impact the group of patients as much as the drug. So let's look at the results on the next page. And one note before we move on. This is going to be a one-tail t-test. Okay, and the reason why it's one-tail is we really want to check and see whether the drug had a positive effect or not. In the other cases, we can say the drug either had a positive or a negative effect. It was two possible outcomes. It could either exist either higher or lower. So the mean can be different because higher or lower. In this case, we're only looking in one direction. So we're going to use a one-tail t-test. So here's the results. And you can see, again, here's my placebo. And I just had to split the columns so I can make it all fit. Okay, so here's a placebo effect. And here's the drug effect. And look, in some cases, the numbers are higher. In some cases, the numbers are higher here. Again, we can't really say much as to what's going on until we run our tests. So we run our stats. And what we come up with is that the mean of the drug was around 30.7 versus placebo, 25.2. Again, we see a larger variance around the drug than the placebo. So does this mean that the drug is really efficacious or not? Well, let's compare the t-stat against the critical, t-critical. Since t-stat is greater than t-critical, 2.14 is greater than 1.69, we have a low p-value below the 0.05, we're going to reject the null hypothesis and say that the placebo had that the drug actually had some effect, that the placebo is not the same as a drug. Okay? So in other words, we reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative hypothesis that the drug likely had a positive effect. So then the question you should ask yourself is, well, what happens if you have more than two sets of data? What if we have three different schools we want to compare, or five different schools? Or what if we're looking at three different drugs or four different amounts of fertilizer to put on our different plants? Okay? Or some other examples, what if we have three people collecting data? Or our samples are taken on four different days? Or the data is measured using four different techniques? Well, doing multiple sets of paired t-tests gets quite painful, as you can imagine. So instead we use a technique called ANOVA. Well, in part 6, we'll review ANOVA. So I look forward to seeing you then.